2 Kings. It's right after 1 Kings and right before 1 Chronicles. 2 Kings chapter 9. 2 Kings chapter 9. We're going to read verses 30 through 37. Now when Jehu had come to Jezreel, Jezebel heard of it. And she put paint on her eyes and adorned her head and looked through a window. Then as Jehu entered at the gate, she said, "Is it peace, Zimri, murderer of your master?" Okay, she called him Zimri. I might get around to telling you why. She was cutting him down. He looked up at the window and said, "Who is on my side? Who?" So two or three eunuchs looked at him. Then he said, "Throw her down." So they threw her down, and some of her blood spattered on the wall and on the horses, and he trampled her underfoot. And when he had gone in, he ate and drank. Then he said, "Go now, see to this accursed woman, and bury her, for she was a king's daughter." So they went to bury her, but they found no more of her than her skull, the feet, and the palms of her hands. Therefore they came back and told him, as he said, "This is the word of the Lord, which he spoke by his servant Elisha the Tishbite, saying, on the plot of ground at Jezreel, dogs shall eat the flesh of Jezebel, and the corpse of Jezebel shall be as refuse on the surface of the field, in the plot at Jezreel, so that they shall not say, here lies Jezebel." This was prophesied by the prophet Elisha years earlier, that dogs would eat her. Hallelujah. Okay, well, first of all, who's Jehu? Jehu was a man chosen by God to be a righteous and a king, to be a righteous king and a deliverer over Israel. They had been ruled by wicked kings, namely Jezebel's husband, King Ahab, and those that followed him. Wicked, wicked kings. Idol worship, promiscuity, you name it. It was involved in their kingdom. But see, Elisha, the prophet, who was the prophet in Elijah's stead, he took his mantle. Elisha sent his servant. And Elisha's servant would have been one of the sons of the prophets, they call them, or school of the prophets. And turn back with me, or just look back in verse 6 of chapter 9. Elisha sent his servant to anoint Jehu to be king. Then he arose and went into the house, and he poured the oil on his head and said to him, "Thus says the Lord God of Israel, I have anointed you king over the people of the Lord, over Israel. You shall strike down the house of Ahab, your master, that I may avenge the blood of my servants, the prophets, and the blood of all the servants of the Lord at the hand of Jezebel. For the whole house of Ahab shall perish, and I will cut off from Ahab all the males in Israel, both bond and free. So I will make the house of Ahab like the house of Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, and like the house of Baasha, the son of Ahijah. The dogs shall eat Jezebel on the plot of ground at Jezreel, and there shall be none to bury her." And he opened the door and fled. Then Jehu came out to the servants of his master, and one said to him, "Is all well? Why did this madman come to you?" Ain't that something? You got a word from God, people think you're a madman, don't they? Uh-huh. Come on, somebody. "Why this man?" He said, "You know the man and his babble." And they said, "A lie. Tell us now." So he said, "Thus and thus he spoke to me, saying, thus says the Lord, I have anointed you king over Israel." Then each man hastened to take his garment and put it under him on top of the steps, and they blew trumpets, saying, "Jehu is king." Of course, Jehu is not actually officially king at this point, but he has been anointed to be so by God. God sent the prophet to do so. Okay, so what's noteworthy about Jehu? Well, I'm going to just give you a encapsulated version of what Jehu did. In verse 24 of the chapter, he killed King Joram, which was the king of Israel, wicked king. He also, in verse 27, he killed King Ahaziah, who was the king of Judah, a wicked king. In verse 33 of this chapter, he killed Jezebel. He either killed these people or he was part of having them killed. Okay, let's put it that way. He killed Jezebel. In verse 33, he killed King Ahab's 70 sons. In chapter 10, verse 7, he killed Ahaziah's 42 brothers. In verse 14, he killed the rest of Ahab's family. In verse 17, he killed all the worshipers of, in verse 25, all the worshipers of Baal, the priests, the servants, and all those who worshiped him. In fact, what he does, he said, I'm going to come to worship Baal. And I want to make sacrifice and all. I want everybody to come. He called them all together, but he played a trick on them. After he got them all together, he killed every one of them. And we're like, and you might think, wow, you know, that's a lot of killing. How do you get rid of sin? You kill it. How do you get rid of sin? You got to kill it. You got to do like Barney Fife said. You got to nip it in the bud. You got to kill it at the root. Amen? That's what he done here. He came in and God told him, he said, you're going to strike down everything that Ahab has done. Okay, Ahab's dead. Ahab's been dead for a few years. And his predecessors are reigning in his stead at this point where Jehu comes on the scene. But he goes out and he kills. He kills. You know, we often wonder, you know, why when they went into the promised land, how could a good, loving God tell him to kill everybody? When you go into the land, he said, kill them all. Men, women, and children, don't leave none of them standing. How can God say that? I heard a fellow say one time that he really struggled with that, really struggled with that. He said, and the Lord spoke to him and said, they're dead already. They were already dead. They were wicked. They were symbolic of, and they were sin. And he knew that if they didn't wipe those people out, that sin would infect, just like a disease, his people when they come into the land. They didn't wipe them out, did they? They didn't wipe them out, and the rest is history. We look at the history of Israel. We see the Babylonian captivity. We even go back and see the 400 years that they were in captivity in Egypt because of their sin and disobedience to God. When God says, do something, do it. Jehu did it. He killed them all. He wiped them out. I like it over here in verse 17 where it says he killed the rest of his family. He made sure he didn't even have any family members left because it was sinful. They were sinful people. Now, in the New Testament day, God don't have us go kill sinners, does he? He has us witness to them. He has us love them. But he has us stand up too, don't he? Hallelujah. Okay. So that's how you get rid of sins. You kill it. You wipe it out. You destroy it. You obliterate it. In verse 30, we see Jezebel, Ahab's wife, looking out of a window. It says that she painted her eyes, she did her hair, and she looked out the window. Well, who is Jezebel? We've already established Jezebel was Ahab's wife. Jezebel was a Phoenician woman. She was not a Jew. So Ahab actually went against the law of God and went outside the Jewish race and married one of the inhabitants of Canaan land, whom they were supposed to kill when they came in and didn't. He actually married one of them, brought him in as his wife. Okay, Jezebel, her name actually means worshiper of Baal, B-A-A-L, a god. A false god. Okay? So Jezebel was known for a few things. She was known for idolatry. She was a priestess to Baal. She was into stuff deep, okay? Ahab went along with it though. She was a killer of the prophets of God. She killed over 100 prophets of God in chapter 18 of 1 Kings. And she was after Elijah too. She didn't get him. God protected him. She was a dominating woman who controlled her spineless excuse for a husband, King Ahab. She ran the kingdom. He was just a puppet. Wow. And if you'll look, there was a land deal involved too with a guy named Naboth. He had a vineyard. She wanted it. She had him killed. Kind of reminds you of a story I heard about some folks in the White House. We had a fellow that his wife kind of run things. And they had a land deal called Whitewater. And the fellow lost his life, Mr. Foster, over it. Yeah. Mm-hmm. History repeats itself, don't it? Mm-hmm. It sure does. Very reminiscent of this. But we're going to move along. We're not going to dabble with that. So she controlled her spineless, sorry excuse of a husband, King Ahab. She was a priestess of Baal. She was considered a whore and a prostitute. Turn with me, keep your finger here, and turn with me to the book of Revelation. Revelation chapter 2. It's easy to find, last book in the Bible. Revelation chapter 2, and I want to start reading in verse 18. This is John the Apostle writing letters to the seven churches of his day. And to the angel of the church in Thyatira write, "These things says the Son of God, who has eyes like a flame of fire and his feet like fine brass. I know your works, love, service, faith, and your patience. And as your works, the last are more than the first. Nevertheless, I have a few things against you, because you allow that woman, Jezebel, who calls herself a prophetess, to teach and seduce my servants to commit sexual immorality and to eat things sacrificed to idols. And I gave her time to repent of her sexual immorality, and she did not repent. Indeed, I will cast her into a sick bed, and those who commit adultery with her into great tribulation, unless they repent of their deeds. I will kill her children with death, and all the churches shall know that I am he who searches the minds and hearts, and I will give to each one of you according to your works." Okay. Jezebel lived, or actually died, in this story we just opened up reading in 843 BC. Okay. What we just read from Revelation was written approximately AD 90. Jezebel wasn't still alive. She didn't escape death. So what's he talking about here? He's talking about a spirit. A spirit of Jezebel. There's a spirit of Jezebel in the church today. Okay, we're not going to get into the spirit of Jezebel per se, because that'd take us down a whole other road. We're going to keep going and talk some more about Jehu here. But she wasn't an actual prostitute. But she was what you call a spiritual prostitute, because she done what God said. She went a whoring after other gods. See, when you leave the one you're espoused to, which is God, and you go chasing another, then you're being unfaithful. It's like being a whore. And that's what he called her, a whore. This woman, this prostitute, this whore. So she was a spiritual prostitute and not a literal prostitute. Although she may have partook in some of the sexual things that they done in the temple in worship of Baal. I don't know about that for sure, though. I didn't find anything concrete on that, so I'm not going to say that that's so. But there's a spirit in the church of Jezebel, and it is a seductive spirit. Verse 30. We find that she paints her face first, and then she looks out the window. Okay. How many growing up ever heard your mama or your grandma call somebody a Jezebel? And we know what they meant too, don't we? Paint your face up like a Jezebel. How many ever watched Sanford and Son? How many ever heard Aunt Esther call somebody a Jezebel? Yeah, that's exactly right. Jezebel was synonymous with a loose woman, right? She was synonymous with a seductress. And that's what this spirit does. It seduces people. We find her looking out the window with her face painted and her hair done at Ahab. But the seduction didn't work. And point number one, God's servants must not be sidetracked. If you're a servant of God, He has given you a calling. He has given you a reason to live. He's given you something you need to do on this earth. But the devil, this seductress, this Jezebel spirit, is going to come along and it's going to try to sidetrack you and trip you up. It may not be a sexual thing. It may be something else. Everybody just stop for a second and think in your mind, what's my weakness? Y'all know what it is, don't you? You didn't have to think long, did you? And if you tell me you ain't got one, you lying. Because you do. Everybody's got a weakness. Everybody's got a weak point. I was talking to somebody this week telling them, you know, the devil don't try no new tricks on you. He don't have to. The old ones have been working too good for too long. We got something that trips us up. That's that Jezebel spirit. Wants to sidetrack you. But he would not be sidetracked. He was on a mission. Hallelujah. Matthew 6:22 says that if your eye is single, that your whole body will be full of light. Wow. What does that mean, your eye be single? I know that the modern translations don't say single. They use different words. But in this particular instance, and I'll tell you when I like it and when I don't like it, I like what the King James used. It used the word single. Okay, the modern translation says if your eye is good, if your eye is healthy. But he used the word single, the King James translator says. And the word single means not complicated or confused. In other words, you got a single vision. Your vision is not divided up a bunch of different things. How many ever heard of ADD? Attention Deficit Disorder. I probably have it. They didn't diagnose me when I was little. They just beat me. You know, that's the way you done it back then. You didn't give them medicine. You just took them out in the hall and give them a good whooping. But somebody has ADD, and I had two girls that were diagnosed with it. They can't keep their mind on what they're doing. I remember Emily, one of my twins. She was in school, Wahlberg School, before Sherry pulled them out of school and began to homeschool them. And they would send her down to the office. She's like third grade maybe, second grade. Send her down to the office to get her Ritalin. Because she needed it, or she would be all over the place. But she hadn't had it yet. And she's walking to the office, and it's in the wintertime, and she looks outside, and it's snowing. The next thing that happens is the kids holler at the teacher and want to know why Emily is allowed to go outside and play in the snow. She's out there making snowballs and trying to build a snowman. You know, It's just like that. You're walking along, she looks and sees something, and bam, impulsive. They're gone. You know, I'm like that. In fact, Sherry gets mad at me because I get mad at her, because if I'm trying to read and she comes up asking me questions or something, it just blows everything I'm doing. And I can't find my place. I can't remember what I was reading. I read the same verse 3 or 4 times. You know, if there's noise in the house, I'm like it. But see, we don't need to be like it. We need to have our eye needs to be single. We need to keep it on our focus on what we are doing. In Philippians 3:14, the Apostle Paul said, I press forward for the mark, for the prize, for the high calling in Christ Jesus. He said, I got my mind on a prize. I got my vision set. I got my goal set. I know where I'm going. Don't be sidetracked. God's servants don't have time to be sidetracked. We got to keep on keeping on. And there's much in this world to sidetrack us today. I'm worried about the church. I'm worried about me. I look at me and I think, what in the world is wrong with me? You know, why am I getting sidetracked? Why am I losing my vision? What's wrong? I know what's wrong. I need more Jesus. That's the only thing that's going to fix it. He's better than Ritalin. Amen? Glory to God. The mark, the price, the high calling in Christ Jesus. 1 Corinthians 9:25 teaches us that they in the world that are like in the Olympics are striving for a crown. That's what they're striving for. They're striving to win the crown. They're striving to win the prize. They're not looking to the left. They're not looking to the right. They got their eyes on the prize. Paul said they strive for a corruptible crown, but we strive for an incorruptible crown. Hallelujah, one that will not perish. Our eye needs to be single. We need to be on a mission. We're on a mission. If you're out there today and you're born again, God's got a mission for you. Well, Brother Tommy, I don't know what that mission is. Well, that's why we have to spend some time looking to find out what it is. You know, things, everything that's worth having ain't easy to get. You know that? If it's worth having, if you worked for it, it's worth having. I'll take care of something I worked hard for a whole lot better than will something somebody just give me, because I got some labor in it. God wants us to work to find out what He's calling for us is today. In verses 32 and 33, it says, "And he looked up at the window and said, 'Who is on my side? Who?' So two or three eunuchs looked out at him. Then he said, 'Throw her down.' So they threw her body over." Number two, God's servants have authority. God's servants have authority. There were two or three eunuchs there. What was a eunuch? A eunuch is a unique, almost rhymes, don't it? Unique eunuchs. A eunuch's a unique individual. He's someone who is commissioned to look after the women, the queen. And just to make sure that they looked after them the right way, they castrated them. And we're all big boys and girls. We can say that word. They castrated them. So these eunuchs have been castrated and consecrated to service, to looking after the queen. Okay, they're the ones that threw her out the window. How's that? The eunuchs belong to her kingdom, a kingdom of darkness. But one word of authority from a servant of God, and they had to obey. Come on, somebody. They had to obey. When Jesus sent the 70 out, two by two, he told them to cast out devils, to heal the sick, to raise the dead. They went out and they done exactly that. They cast out the devils. They raised the dead. They healed the sick. They opened blinded eyes. And they come back and they said, "Jesus, you're not going to believe us, but even the demons are subject to us in your name." You know why? Because Jesus had given them authority. God's servants have authority. Glory to God. Acts 8:7, last week. We read it 2 weeks in a row. As a matter of fact, we're not going to read it this week. We're just going to talk about it. Acts 8:7, we find Philip coming to Samaria to preach. Philip the evangelist. And he done what an evangelist does. He preached the gospel of Jesus Christ to them. And it says that unclean spirits with a loud voice came out of many who were possessed. Well, why did those spirits come out? Because Philip had authority. He had authority given him by God to cast those spirits out. I want you to know something. If you are a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ, you have authority. You have a spiritual authority. See, that's what's wrong with us. We live our whole lives in the natural. We were born in the natural. We lived our lives in the natural. Some point in our life, we decided that we needed a Savior, and we got saved. But we still live in the natural, not realizing that when we were born again, we were made spiritual beings, and we were given spiritual authority. that the Holy Spirit of God came to live inside of us, and that we were no longer just natural beings like everybody else, but we were supernatural beings with supernatural power and authority. And God has given all of us that power and authority. Hallelujah. Ephesians 2:6 says that we are raised up together to sit with Christ in heavenly places. Wow. Where is Christ seated right now? He's at the right hand of God, and he's sitting where? On a throne. So if I'm seated together with Christ in heavenly places, I'm sitting next to him on his throne. Well, Tommy, we're not seated with Christ in heavenly places. We're sitting here in the church pew. In the natural, yes, you are. See, there's two ways we look at our salvation and our existence with God. That is our positional righteousness and position, and our practical righteousness and position. And it's hard for some people, for those who like to keep the law, and we probably talked about this some in Romans Wednesday night, it's hard for some people to catch on to the fact that positionally in God, I am seated in heavenly places with him in his throne, that I am forgiven of my sins, that my spirit man is perfect and holy and untarnished before God because of the blood of Jesus, even though my natural practical side might not be there yet. Hallelujah. That's good news. That's good news. It's good news to know that's how God sees me. He don't see me as a failure. Thank God. My natural daddy, and I'm going to be careful not to speak a curse on myself in some way by dishonoring my father and mother. But my father was, he would tell you that you're not going to be anything. You never amount to nothing. Everything you touch turns to you know what. You can't do nothing right. Why don't you get your head out of your... Yeah. I even asked him one time if he wanted me to go get his tractor so he could pull my head out of... Yeah. I'm laughing now. It wasn't funny then. You know, and I feel like that I've suffered the consequences of those words. Words do have power. Now, we could get into a whole different teaching there, and I could show you where... You know, that some people have taken that too far, and they have. But our words do have power. They affect. They affect how things we speak to each other. And that affected me. Hallelujah. But I'm not that. I'm not a failure. I'm not somebody that can't do nothing right. I've got somebody living in me that does everything right. The Bible says he does all things well. Hallelujah. I got somebody that makes up the difference. When I can't make it, he makes it for me. Come on, somebody. I know some people don't like this kind of preaching. They say, you're getting into that grace preaching. Well, how in the world can you read this book and not see grace? That's what it's all about. It's grace, 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 grace. From the top to the bottom, from the start to the finish, it's about God's grace. Hallelujah. Verses 34 through 37. And when he had gone in, he ate and drank. Then he said, go now, see to this accursed woman and bury her. For she was a king's daughter. So they went to bury her, but they found no more of her than the skull and the feet and the palms of her hands. Therefore they came back and told him what he said. This is the word of the Lord, which was spoken by the servant Elijah the Tishbite, saying, On the plot of ground at Jezreel, dogs shall eat the flesh of Jezebel, and the course of Jezebel shall be as refuse on the surface of the field in the plot of Jezreel, so that they shall not say, here lies Jezebel. There wasn't nothing left of her that the dogs didn't eat, but her head, her feet, in the palms of her hands. I didn't plan to go into this today, but I'll just touch it because that could be a whole other message. Why didn't the dogs eat her head, her hands, and her feet? What's the difference? Dogs eat everything. Dogs are scavengers, aren't they? In fact, dogs were not highly spoken of in the Old Testament at all, like they are today. You know, people love some dogs today, but they ain't highly spoken of in the Old Testament. They were scavengers. It's a symbolism there. Everywhere Jezebel walked was to do evil. Everywhere she went was to do evil continually. Her hands, everything she touched was to bring about something evil. The work of her hands was continually evil. Her head, everything she thought, every thought she had was continually mischievous and evil to do something wrong. Even the dogs had enough sense that they didn't want no part of that. Amen? It's just like the pigs that were filled with the demons when Jesus cast them out of Legion. See, there were 2,000 pigs, and he cast the demons out of Legion, the man who had the demons at the tombs, into the pigs. It said the pigs ran down the bank, run into the water, and drowned. Pigs got more sense than most people got. They'd rather be dead than be demon-possessed. But that's where these dogs are. That's symbolic of her life right there. And it's a fulfillment of prophecy and judgment that came true. And how many knows if God said it, it's going to happen? That's why I can sit back and look at the world and what's going on today, and I can say I'm not worried about it because I know what God said. I know what's going to happen. I've read the last chapter of the book, and I know who wins. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Even if I lose, I win. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. So while Jehu was eating lunch, the dogs were eating Jezebel. Ain't that something? While he was in having his lunch, the dogs were down there eating her body. That reminds me of Psalm 23:5. He said, "He will prepare a table before you in the presence of your enemies." Hallelujah. Jehu was feasting and having a good old time eating his lunch while his enemy laid out in the street and the dogs were eating her body. Hallelujah. That's Jesus. Psalm 27 says, "Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid?" You don't have no fear. If you know Jesus and you're walking in Jesus, we don't have any fear. See, fear is a spirit that grips people. Fear comes from Satan. It doesn't come from God. God's not giving us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and a sound mind. He's not giving us a spirit of fear, but he's giving us a spirit of adoption whereby we cry, "Abba, Father," hallelujah. God is not the author of fear. So if you're scared of something, you got to realize where it's coming from. There's a place that we need to get to where we just have this sober conscience, trust in God and his word, not to let the things that we see move us. I'm not moved by what I see. I'm not moved by what I feel. I'm moved by what I believe. Come on, somebody. And what do I believe? I believe the everlasting word of God, which will stand and already has stood through time and eternity. Hallelujah. That's where we stand at. Praise God. God gives his servants rest from and victory over their enemies. Praise God. Keep your finger there in 1 Kings, because we're about done. And we'll look at Joshua chapter 1, verse 9. This scripture may sound familiar, and there is a reason for that. But we'll go ahead and read it. "Have I not commanded you, be strong and of good courage? Do not be afraid. Do not be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you should go. Did we hear that somewhere else today? Did anybody else hear that today? Anywhere else? Like in the second song we sang? Be bold, be strong, for the Lord thy God is with thee. That's what he told them. That's what Joshua said. He said, I commission you, I command you, be strong, be of good courage, be bold, for the Lord your God is with you everywhere you go. Matthew 28:28, Jesus said, lo, I am with thee always, even till the end of the age, or end of the world. I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. Do we believe it or not? It's time we become believers. What better time? I'm already a believer. Are we not? We only believe a little bit. The Bible says that we walk from faith to faith. From faith in the beginning to faith to the end. Or, as I talked about on Wednesday night, it's like a ladder climbing up rungs. We're going one step of faith higher to another step of faith. Glory to God. It never gets old and boring like that. If your walk's getting old and boring, you need to have a checkup from a neck up. Because there's no bottom to this thing. There's no end to it. The depths, we can't reach them. Not in this life. Hallelujah. So just keep on keeping on. God gives his servants rest from and victory over their enemies. Back to 2 Kings chapter 10, verses 30 and 31. That's the ending of this story. And the Lord said to Jehu, because you have done well in doing what is right in my sight, and have done to the house of Ahab all that was in my heart, your son shall sit on the throne of Israel to the fourth generation. There was a blessing right there, okay? But Jehu took no heed to walk in the law of the Lord, God of Israel, with all his heart, for he did not depart from the sins of Jeroboam, who made Israel to sin. That's a sad ending to the story, ain't it? He said, but because of what you've done right, he said, I'm going to see that your sons sit on the throne to the fourth generation. There was a blessing for keeping his eyes single. There was a blessing for walking in authority. And there was a blessing for carrying out God's vision and justice. But we find out in the end that Jehu did not follow the law of the Lord God with all of his heart. And see, that's what we have today. We have churches who are doing many, many things, but they're not following the law of the Lord God with all their heart. It's called having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof. See, we can go through the motions and do the things that God's called us to do. But if we're not doing it in the power of the Holy Spirit, we'll end up like Jehu here. We'll end up finishing last in the end of our life. But see, we don't have to finish that way. We can finish strong. Because there's something that we got that Jehu didn't have. This was the Old Testament. Jesus had never come to the cross yet. Jesus had not died and paid for his sins yet. Therefore, if Jesus hadn't died and paid for his sins, then the Holy Spirit had not come yet. So we have a little extra something going for us, guys. Jesus has came and died on the cross of Calvary. He has sent the Holy Spirit to dwell in us. And through the power of the Holy Spirit, we don't have to have an end, a finishing like this, but we can finish strong. In closing, turn with me to 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 6. This is the Apostle Paul talking to Timothy. The Apostle Paul is in chains. The Apostle Paul is getting ready. I got the wrong scripture. 2 Timothy 4:6. Sorry about that. And he is ready to be executed. He's going to be executed. Nero is going to behead the Apostle Paul because he's a Christian. And these are Apostle Paul's words before this happens. Chapter 4, verse 6. For I am already being poured out as a drink offering, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Finally, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give to me on that day, and not to me only, but also to all who have loved his appearing. Paul said, I know whom I have believed, and I'm persuaded that he is able to keep that which I have committed unto him against that day. He says here, I'm ready to be offered up. Go ahead, do it. And I probably have told you this before, and you can find out these facts from Stephen's Book of Martyrs, that the Apostle Paul was beheaded. And at the Apostle Paul's request, he wanted to be headed face up. He said he wanted to see it coming because he knew where he was going. Hallelujah. That's how I want to finish. That's how we want to finish today, guys. We want to finish strong. And with the power of the Holy Spirit, as we die to ourselves and live unto Him, we are able to finish strong and finish in the power of God. And we can truly say, I'm ready to be offered up. If that's what you want to do to me, and if that's God's will to allow that to happen to me, so be it. I'm ready. Hallelujah. Well, that's all I have this morning. I'd like to close with a word of prayer. Lord Jesus, we thank you and praise you. We thank you and praise you for this people that are here today. We pray somebody was encouraged or stirred by this word today to serve God, to serve you with your all in all. But Lord, I'd like to know if there's somebody here in this congregation this morning, every head bowed, every eye closed, that would say, Brother Tommy, I don't know this Jesus that you're talking about. I don't know where I'm going like the Apostle Paul did. I can't say if I die today, I know I'll go to heaven. Would you pray for me? Just lift your hand up. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. If there are those here today who have sickness in body, if they'd like prayer for, I'd like to open up the altar. The altar's never closed here, by the way. You can come down the front and receive prayer for healing, encouragement, whatever you need. Is anybody like that here this morning? I have one taker. Hallelujah. Glory. Anybody else? Her name? Okay, right now, in the name of Jesus, we lift up Sandra to you.